We still need the Lord, amen? We need Him every hour of every day, because without Him, then there is nothing that we can do. And there can really be no real joy and happiness without the Lord. We will never know those things without Him. So that is why it is very important that each and every one of us will learn the things that He's teaching us from His Word, that we may be able to be a blessing to the Lord, to other people, and that His name will be glorified because of the things that we are doing or we will do in life. Okay, shall we stand up? We are going to read only one verse, but we are going to read many verses as we go along in our study in the book of Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 2, and we will read verse number 1. Okay, we will read this in unison, of course. Ready? Read. Therefore, we ought to give the more earnest seed to the things which we have heard, lest at any time we should let them slip. Father, once again, we are thankful for this time that we could pray. Thank you, Lord, because we know that you heard our prayers and you have answered them, or the answer is already on the way. And if the answer is not exactly as we are hoping for or asking for, you know what is best, O God, and that is what you are going to give to our prayers. I pray, Lord, that you will continually cleanse us and make us worthy, O God, to always be a worthy vessel of your word. Help us, Lord, not only to understand the things that are written in the Bible, but most of all, Lord, help us that we may be able to apply them so that, Lord, it will do us well, will make us better, Lord, and we'll be able, O God, to experience how it is really to be your child, your servant, and your soldier. I pray, Lord, that you will use me tonight to be a blessing to your people, and that your people will listen attentively, that we may see, Lord, your plan in our lives, and that we may see, Lord, the important things that will be divulged to us through your word. We thank you. We love you, Jesus. We thank you for loving us first. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. May be seated. Thank you very much. Okay, we are going to look at several warnings that are written here in the book of Hebrews regarding Christians. So we know that the book of Hebrews is not written to unbelievers. It is written to Christians, particularly the Jewish Christians or the Hebrew Christians that are scattered in places and that are in the church during that time. They have a very unique situation because Judaism and Christianity, though both came from God, is not one and the same. There are things that they practice in Judaism that are only a shadow of the things to come, but the substance is the Lord Jesus Christ. So they are always in danger of going back to their former ways because they are used to that in worshiping the Lord. And for so many years, thousands of years, it's the only way that is acceptable unto God. At least not for salvation merely, but for a people chosen by God to give a testimony to the world so that the light that was given to them may also be shared to the world, so that when the substance, which is the Lord Jesus Christ, will come, then there will be a full and mature understanding of all the things that were are being embodied in the religion or the practice of Judaism. So in short, these people got saved and they are now a part of the New Testament or the New Covenant given by God to those who believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. So their situation, as I have said, is unique because of the zeal of the Judaizers that are still trying to pull them out of the practice of Christianity to revert back again to practicing Judaism. And some of them are being enticed by the Judaizers, and some are standing true to their new covenant with the Lord. But because of the dangers that they are facing, so the author of the book of Hebrews, most probably the Apostle Paul, have written warnings so that they will be warned and be reminded so as not to drift away or revert back to the practice of Judaism, which will not benefit them at all. Because, as I have said, those are only shadow of the things to come, but the substance is already here. Now, as we listen to Brother Jeremiah, as he is giving us a series in the book of Hebrews, we can see that the key word in the epistle is the word better. There's a better covenant. Lord Jesus Christ is better than the angels. The Lord Jesus Christ is better than the patriarch. His priesthood is better than Aaronic priesthood. So we can see that all the things that are incorporated with the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ is much better than all the things that are written in the Old Covenant. The reason why the Old Covenant is changed with the New Covenant, because the New Covenant is far more superior than the Old Covenant. What the Old Covenant cannot do, the New Testament achieve. While the Old Covenant can only teach us that we are sinners, the New Testament or the New Covenant taught us how to be forgiven of that sin, be justified, and be saved. Amen. So that's why we will see that word better so many times in the book of Hebrews. It is very much better to be a Christian than not to be one. That is for sure. Much better. There is no comparison. For God has so many better things in store for His people. If the Israelites, though not technically saved, were blessed by God in so many ways, how much more the people that are now called the children of God. So God has in store for us so many things that if we are just going to be obedient to the Lord and do His will, then we are going to enjoy all of these things in our lives that I believe will make us satisfied beyond measure. But on the other hand, the Christians are constantly in danger of losing not our salvation, but the reward that God has promised us to those who will follow Him. So there is a danger of losing our reward. There is a danger of losing our fellowship with the Lord. There is that danger of losing the joy of our salvation. You see, salvation was given that we might have an abundant life. And that abundant life will result into joy, the fullness of joy that only God can give. It will give us peace even in the midst of the storm. It is something that passeth all understanding. It is the grace that can make us sing even inside the prison. It can make us hope even though we are engulfed with so much negative circumstances in life. That's why a Christian who is obedient to the Lord, no matter what he may face in life, will always find joy and peace in the presence of the Lord. Amen. Amen. So that is why it is very important that we experience these things that God hath given or wants to give those who believe in Him. You see, Christians can be careless and we can be neglectful. And because of that, we will fail to progress into maturity. We will fail to become all that God has planned or purposed for us to be. You see, when we got saved, God has a plan. The Bible says that we are, before we got saved, we are in the flesh, we are in the old Adamic nature, but when we got saved because of God's grace through faith, we became a new creature, and that new creature is now created unto good works. So if we are not going to be obedient to God, we are not going to become or practically will become practically that creature of doing good works, and therefore by not obeying these things, we are not going to receive the blessings and the reward that God has planned to give each and every one of us. That is why if you will go to Hebrews chapter 6 and verse number 1, we are exhorted, he says, therefore leaving the principles of the doctrine of Christ, let us go on unto perfection, not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works and of faith toward God. So the author of Hebrews is encouraging us to go to spiritual maturity. Amen. Because only spiritually matured Christians will be used by the Lord in His vineyard. We may be a Christian, we may be a child of God, we may be a soldier, we may be a servant of the Lord, but if we are not going to become mature, then we are going to be ineffective. And if we will be ineffective, then we are going to be useless in the ministry of the Lord. Sometimes instead of being a help or a blessing, we are actually becoming a stumbling block, so that the purpose of God in the lives of so many people will not come to pass. That is why it is very important that we should not drift away, but we should go on unto maturity. Listen, it is not possible for a Christian or a truly born-again child of God to fall away and lose his salvation. That is impossible. That is something that will never happen according to the Word of God and much of the verses that are written in the book of Hebrews. Hebrews, what are the reasons why we cannot lose our salvation? For one, we are elected by God. Amen? So if you are elected by God, God never commits mistakes. Therefore, you're not going to lose your salvation. Don't get me wrong. Our election is based on the foreknowledge of God. He knew those who will repent of their sins and receive Jesus as their Savior, and therefore, by virtue of His sovereignty, of being all-knowing, He elected us in order to conform to the image, or predestined us to conform to the image of His dear Son. Look at Romans chapter 8, verses 29 to 30. The Bible says, for whom He did foreknow, maliwanag yan, He also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of His Son, that He might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom He did predestinate, them He also called, and whom He called, them He also justified, and whom He justified, them He also glorified, all in the premise that God knows everything. Amen. In the premise of the foreknowledge of God. And therefore, as being justified, as being called, as being elected, and being glorified, there is no way that we are going to lose our salvation. Amen. Look at Ephesians chapter 1, verse number 4. according as He had chosen us in Him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before Him in love. That is a part of being a new creature, that we are created to become holy and without blame in the Lord. Look at chapter 2, verse number 10. Ephesians 2:10. The Bible says, "For we are His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them." So He ordained. Because if the election or foreordination of God is, according to the Calvinists, something that is something that is without a cause, that it is just according to the good pleasure of God, that He elected those who will be saved, and those who God did not elect will go to hell, even though without any action in our part or anything that we have done, then therefore that when God foreordained us unto good work, therefore all of us should only be doing good works, because that is our foreordination. We are ordained unto good works. Therefore, everything that we will do will always be good works. But why is it that we still sin? Why is it that we can still do the things that the flesh is enticing us or tempting us to do? Why? Because there is always a choice. Because there is always a spiritual condition that if we will choose to obey God, then He will enable us to obey Him. But if we will choose to disobey God, then our flesh will be enabled to have the power over us. But we will never lose our salvation, no matter, because we are the workmanship of God. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 9. "Who hath saved us and called us with an holy calling, not according to our works, but according to His purpose and grace, which was given us in Christ Jesus before the world began." At first glance, you will think that this is just what the Calvinists are saying, that according to His good pleasure, He just, you know, saved us. But this is always predicated upon the foreknowledge of God, because it was already established when we read Romans chapter 8, verses 29 to 30. But what is clear here is that there is a purpose of grace of God in our lives. Amen? And that is why we need to be obedient to God, that we may be able to glorify Him in our lives. And then 1 Peter 1, 2. "Elect according to the foreknowledge of God." Yun yung maliwanag din kasi. That should never be forgotten. If there are verses that may seem to teach that we are elected by God, that He just want to save whom He want to save, that is not what the Bible is teaching. What the Bible is teaching is that those who will believe, those who will repent of their sin, will be saved. And the reason why God elected them is because God knows beforehand that they are going to do that. Meaning to say, God knew that in May 14, 1986, I'm going to repent of my sin, and I'm going to open my heart and receive Jesus as my Savior. Even though I was not yet born, God already knows that, because God knows everything. Amen? "Elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, through sanctification of the Spirit, unto obedience and sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ, grace unto you, and peace be multiplied." So we cannot lose our salvation because of election. Not only that, Because the work of Jesus is complete. Look at Hebrews chapter 1, verse number 3. Who being the brightness of His glory and the express image of His person, and upholding all things by the word of His power, when He had by Himself purged our sins, sat down on the right hand, on the majesty on high. What does sitting down or sat down mean? It means that His work is finished. What is that work? Purging us from our sins. Amen? When He purged us, when He saved us. Look at Hebrews 7:25. And this will be very clear. Wherefore, He is able also to save them to the uttermost that come unto God by Him, seeing He ever liveth to make intercession for them. So if the work of salvation is complete and lacking nothing, therefore those that are saved will be saved forever. Amen? It is secured because it is something that is complete. Not only that, but because salvation is of grace. Salvation is an unmerited favor from God that was or is offered to us and is based on our repentance of faith and obedience and a fair repentance of our sins and faith towards God. So when that grace, unmerited favor, was offered to us and we receive it, that gift of God, then we are saved by His grace. And because our salvation is not on our merit, therefore we cannot lose it on our demerit. We need to understand that. Hindi ka naligtas ng gawa mo, kaya hindi ka na maipapahamak ng gawa mo matapos kang mailigtas. Sapagkat kahit lahat ng ating gawa nung hindi pa tayo ligtas ay masama, nailigtas tayo nung tayo ay magsisi at tinanggap siya. Therefore, anuman ang ating gagawin matapos tayong maligtas ay hindi makakaapekto sa ating kaligtasan. Pero may apekto yan sa ating mga gantimpala na ibibigay ng Panginoon at the judgment seat of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Not only that, because salvation is eternal. What the Lord has given us is eternal life, and eternal life has no end. So therefore, when God saved you, when God gave you eternal life, that life is yours forever. And nobody is able to take that away from you. Why? Because the God who gave it is greater than all. And no man is able to pluck us out of the hands of God. Amen? We are saved and we cannot lose our salvation because of the promise of Scripture. Look at John 5:24. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that heareth my word and believeth on him that sent me hath everlasting life and shall not come into condemnation. Hindi na ahatulan pa. Hindi na mako-condemn, shall not come unto condemnation, but is passed from death unto life. Why? Because death was already paid for as the penalty of our sin, and we are passed from that, and we are now living unto life. Amen? So many verses, John 10:28-29. This is very clear. John 10:28-29. And I give unto them eternal life, what was given to those who believe, eternal life. And they shall never, never perish. Are we going to still perish? Never. Is there a chance that we will perish? No chance. Because it is never. It is the strongest negative word that we can use in English. Never means no chance at all. And they shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. My Father which gave them me is greater than all. And no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand. That is the promise of the Scripture. If the Bible is the Word of God, and the Word of God is true, and God can never lie, and God is true to His promise, therefore we are sure that we will go to heaven when we die. Amen? And because God is working in our lives, and He will finish that work. God will never start a work that He will never finish. Look at Philippians chapter 1, verse 6. Being confident, sabi ni Paul, of this very thing, that He which hath begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. So that's the promise of the Scripture, that we will never lose our salvation. Not only that, but because we are united with Christ. If we are united in Him, no man will be able to separate us, according to the book of Romans. Even life, nor death, nor any other creature, nor things present, nor things to come, will be able to separate us from the love of Christ, which is in God, which is in Christ Jesus. Amen? So therefore, that union will remain forever. It cannot be severed. Why? Look at John 1, 12 to 13. But as many as receive Him, to them gave He power to become the sons of God. What are we now? The sons of God. Is there a way that we can be unborn if we were already born into the family of God? No chance. So that union will remain forever. Amen? And not only that, because of the work of the Holy Spirit in salvation. Look at Ephesians 1, 13 to 14. In whom ye also trusted, after that ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also after that ye believed, ye were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. What is that? It is a sign of possession. It means that we belong to God. What is that seal? Which is the earnest or the down payment or the surety of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession unto the praise of glory of God. So when the Holy Spirit, we were sealed by the Holy Spirit, that already sealed the deal. It can never be negated. We can never be reclaimed by the devil. We are already claimed by God. Ephesians 4, 30, please. And grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby ye are sealed unto the day of redemption. So that seal is unto the day of redemption, when the Lord Jesus Christ will come, or when the day that we will die to be with Him forever. So what is possible is for us to fall away. It is possible for us to lose our rewards. It is possible for us to lose our good fellowship with God. It is possible for us to lose our reward from the Lord, or the joy of salvation, but it is not possible that we will lose our salvation. Amen? So in connection with this, the author of Hebrews gives warnings to Christians so that we will be able to avoid the things that may happen to us should we choose not to obey God. What are those things? Number one, we will be disciplined by God here in this world while we are living. And number two, we will lose our reward when we are standing at the judgment seat of the Lord Jesus Christ. So those are the two things that will happen. But we will never go to hell anymore. Hell is not a question anymore. We are saved from the penalty of sin, but we are not yet saved from the power of sin, and we will yet be saved from the presence of sin. So what are the warnings given to us in the book of Hebrews? Okay, number one is drifting away. Drifting away. In Hebrews chapter 2, verses 1 to 3, the Bible says, therefore, we ought to give the more earnest heed, need to be serious to this, to the things which we have heard, lest at any time we should let them slip. That's why it's very important to remember the things that we are hearing from the Word of God. It is very important to remember the things that we are reading from the Word of God. We should not let them slip from our mind and from our hearts. For if the word spoken by angels was steadfast, and every transgression and disobedience received a just recompense of reward, how shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation, which at the first began to be spoken by the Lord, and was confirmed unto us by them that heard him? So, in this warning, it is an illustration of, you know, sometimes a boat or a ship, when they are not securely fastened to the moor, will, because of inactivity, because of the wave of the ocean or the sea, will slowly be drifting away from the shore. And you may not, that ship may not realize, or the captain of that ship or that boat may not realize that they are so far away from the shore anymore before they realize what is happening. I experienced that. If you have a what do you call that? Yung salvavida, ano ba sa English yan? No, it's not life vest, but interior. And if you are just going to lie there and just pretend to be sleeping or just relaxing, you will not notice that when you look at the shore, you will be far away from that shore. It means that you are drifting away and you are getting into what we call a dangerous situation or a dangerous place. And how can that happen to a Christian? By sheer inactivity. When you forget to pray, when you forget to read your Bible, when you forget to attend church or neglect to attend church, when you do not do the things that God is asking us to do so that our faith will grow in the Lord, then we are slowly going to drift away to the point that we may not realize that we are so far from the shore. And because of that, we might lose hope, or we may not do anything but just drift away into oblivion. So that is the danger of that. Because you see, there are people, if they think that they can still make it, they will try to do everything that they have in their power in order to reach whatever they want to reach. But there are people, when they see that they are so far away from their goal or from what they want to accomplish, they will simply give up and will not do anything anymore. And that is dangerous. Because when the devil lull us to sleep, then he will continue to rock the cradle so that we will not realize that we are in a precarious situation that we are not going to desire to serve God anymore. How does he do that? As I have said, by inactivity or wrong activity. That we are becoming preoccupied with the unimportant things in this world, or focusing our eyes on the things that are temporal rather than the things that are eternal. If you have focused your eyes on the things of this world, and if you have learned to love this world, who offers the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, then you are going to never, or may not realize, that there are more important things than the things that we can see. in this world. And it's sad to say, so many Christians are holding on to the things that are sin, not to the things that are not sin. Why? Because for so many Christians, the things that are not sin are unimportant. Because anyway, you cannot see them. Anyway, you cannot have them. Anyway, you are not in the situation of the things that are eternal. So, you may not put much importance to that. Actually, we do not have to look for any other example. It is just the example of God is always present, but we cannot see Him. But even though we know that God is present, and yet we still continue to commit sin even in His presence. Why? Because we do not give much importance, or we neglect the things that are not sin, even God, whom we cannot see. So that is why there is the danger of drifting away. Not only that, the second one is the danger of unbelief. The danger of unbelief. A Christian can still have an evil heart of unbelief, even though he already believed in God for salvation. But faith in God for salvation is different than faith for service or faith for sanctification. Look at Hebrews chapter 3, verses 12 to 19. Take heed, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. But exhort one another daily while it is called today, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. For we are made partakers of Christ if we hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast unto the end. While it is said, today if you will hear His voice, harden not your hearts as in the day of provocation. For some, when they had heard, did provoke. Howbeit not all that came out of Egypt by Moses. But with whom was he grieved 40 years? Was it not with them that had sinned, whose carcasses fell in the wilderness? And to whom sware he that they should not enter into his rest, but to them that believe not? So we see that they could not enter in because of unbelief. Now, the cult will use this in order to prove that we can lose our salvation. That when our belief turns to unbelief, then we are going to lose the salvation or our rest. But we already studied, if you listen to Brother Jeremiah, that there are different kinds of rest. There is the rest of salvation, and there is the rest of victory in Christ. And we are not going to enter into this rest of a victorious Christian life if we are going to have an evil heart of unbelief. Why? Because sin is deceitful. Amen? And if you are deceived by sin, it will harden your heart. And when your heart is hardened, it will not be affected by the Word of God anymore. And if the Word of God cannot penetrate our hearts anymore, then we will continue in living in unbelief. Or meaning to say, not trusting God in our lives, but doing things according to our own understanding. Amen? Look at Hebrews chapter 4, 1 and 2. Let us therefore fear, lest a promise being left us of entering into His rest, any of you should seem to come short of it. For unto us was the gospel preached as well as unto them. But the word preached did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in them that heard it. Meaning to say, they heard the word of God. They heard what was preached. And because it was not mixed with faith, then it did not profit them. Even us, even if we listen to all the preaching in the world, if we are not going to mix it with faith, then it is not going to profit each and every one of us. Amen? That's why we need to take God at His word. Look at Hebrews 11:6. But without faith, it is impossible to please Him. For he that cometh to God must believe that He is, and that He is a rewarder of them that diligently seek Him. So if there is unbelief, then we're not going to enjoy the blessings of God in our lives. What is unbelief? It is like turning our back upon God. Yes, you believe in God for salvation, but you believe in yourself for your Christian life. You may not want to sacrifice, you may want prosperity in this world. Because you see, there are verses in the Bible that may mean another thing if you are looking at an angle of only that you will only benefit in a physical or material way. Okay, like for example, the Lord Jesus Christ says, I am come that they might have life, and that they might have it more abundantly. So you're going to look at that word abundantly in a financial or materialistic angle. And therefore you will say that because I am a child of God, then God wanted me to become rich, to have the things of this world, to have an abundant things that this world can offer me, because God is giving it to me. So if you look at the verses that may ask you to sacrifice, to deny yourself, you're not going to do that. You're not going to obey that. You are going to explain that away. But when you read verses that may speak of blessing, you will only look at it in a materialistic way. So therefore, you are going to trust your own understanding and not trusting God in all your ways. So that is the danger of having an evil heart of unbelief. It is a dangerous sin, unbelief. And sin is so deceitful. As I have said, when you are deceived, then you are going to continue doing it, not realizing that you have been deceived. Sabi ko nga, ano ang karakteristik ng nadadaya? Hindi niya alam na nadadaya siya. Ewan ko sino nagsugal sa inyo, ako sugal ako dati. Pag dinadaya ka, hindi mo alam yun. Dahil kung alam mo, titigil ka o magre-reklamo ka. So hindi mo alam na nadadaya ka. Kaya patuloy yun until ma-realize mo na dinadaya ka. And that is sin. Until we realize that we are being deceived by sin, we will just continue to sin. And if you will continue to do that, and you got used to it, then it will harden your heart. And when our heart is hard already, then it will grieve the Holy Spirit. And when the Holy Spirit is grieved, then we cannot enjoy the blessings of God in our lives. Amen? So that is why it is dangerous to have an evil heart of unbelief. That's why, as Christians, when the Bible says it, it must settle it. Do not give your own opinion. God is not asking for your opinion. God is asking for our obedience. It is not for us to understand everything that God says. It is for us to obey everything that God says. That is our business. Why? Because there are simply things that we may not be able to understand now. Like Noah, he did not understand what he was doing for 120 years. He doesn't understand it. A boat in the middle of the mountain with no rain, with no water in sight. But God simply says, I am going to flood this world with water. I will cover this world with water and judge the world. He doesn't understand it. But he simply obeyed. Why? Because God knows what is best. If God says it, then it is going to be for the best if we will obey God. Then the danger of spiritual immaturity or remaining babes in Christ. You see, we have children here in the church. When we look at babies or those that are young, sometimes we say that, you know, it's good to remain young. They have no problems. Di ba? Look, they will sleep, they will wake up, they will cry, you will feed them, they will goo 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 for a while, and then will sleep again. They have no problem. So I think it's good to just remain a babe. Because life is not complicated when you are a child. But then again, try to understand and realize that the mind of a child cannot comprehend so many things. They could not enjoy what an adult may enjoy. Like for example, food. They may not enjoy food. Most babies do not understand the taste of food. They will not understand the joy of walking and running. Or maybe some of our young children here are already walking and running and all of these things. But they may not enjoy the joy of, you know, traveling, of having responsibility and doing it, and accountability, and so many things that this world can offer. That is the same thing in our spiritual life. There are so many things that God wants us to experience that we will never experience if we will become contented to be babes in Christ. That's why look at Hebrews chapter 5, verses 11 to 14. This is what the Bible says. Of whom we have many things to say and hard to be uttered, seeing ye are dull of hearing. You see? I have so many things to say that will make you joyful, that will amaze you, that will give you more insight about the Lord, that you may know Him more. But you are dull of hearing. Why? Because you're babes. You see, babes do not have that long of a span of attention. That's why when you're talking to them, you need to always remind them, look at me when I'm talking to you. Because their mind is always wandering. They have no concentration. He said, for when for the time that ye ought to be teachers, ye have need that one teach you again, which be the first principles of the oracles of God, and are become such as have need of milk and not of strong meat. Ang sarap ng bulalo. Amen? Hindi naman alam ng bata ang lasa niyan. Ang sarap ng utak ng iyo, ginagano mo yung sa bulalo. Hindi alam ng bata yan. Hindi sila maamak, ang nakakain lang nila. Inom gatas. Yung pipuree mo na carrot, mashed potato, yun ang mga isusubo mo sa kanila. Hindi nila ma-enjoy yung pagkain na pang-matured, pang-adult. Why? They are babes. Limited sila. Tayo, pwede tayong mashed potato, di ba? Pwede rin tayo. Pwede tayong gatas. Pero pwede tayo ng mga yung sa Korean, yung pork belly, yung grill. Yung mga bata, hindi nila kaya pa yan. They could not enjoy that. For everyone that useth milk is unskillful in the word of righteousness, for he is babe. But strong meat belongeth to them that are of full age, even those who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. And then the next verse, chapter 6. Therefore, leaving these things, leaving the preliminary things. Why? We should have gone past all of these things. Kaya nakakalungkot sa ating panahon ang daming babes in Christ. Hanggang ngayon, nagtatalo-talo pa rin patungkol sa sinner's prayer. Nagtawagan na sila, demonyo. Yan turo mo galing sa impyerno. Nagmumurahan na. Hindi naman yung mura ng sanlibutan, ha? Pero masasakit na yung salita. Nagkakampi-kampihan na. Samantalang pag in-analyze mo, katulad nga ng paulit-ulit kong sinasabi, Pareho lang naman. Sino rito ang nag-repeat after me? Ako. Sino pa? Repeat after me. O halos tayong lahat eh. Para sa kanila, hindi tayo saved kasi nag-repeat after me tayo. Ang hindi nila alam, bago ako nag-repeat after me, sumampalataya na ako. So naligtas na ako. Nung ipa-repeat after me ako, hindi ako doon naligtas sa repeat after me. Ganun na kasimple yun. Ngayon, dapat ba na-repeat after me? Hindi. Dapat, ang naligtas, sumampalataya, kaya niyang manalangin ng kusa. Ba't kailangan mo pa siyang i-repeat after me kasi? Ayun, di ba? Siyempre, yung mga yon sincere naman sila, akala nila ganun ang proseso. Kaya nag-repeat after me sila. Pero hindi sila naniniwala na kaya sila naligtas ay dahil dun sa repeat after me. Dahil kung naniniwala ka, kaya ka naligtas, dahil sa repeat after me, ay impyerno ka. Hindi ka naligtas. Hindi mo naunawaan ang kaligtasan. So it is not about reciting the sinner's prayer or not. It is about repentance and faith. That is the issue. And if I have repented and have put my faith in God, no matter what I said, after that is inconsequential because I am already saved. When it comes to my salvation, nanampalataya ako, naligtas ako, tapos sabi ko, Panginoon, sa oras na ito, tinatanggap kita bilang aking Panginoon at tagapagligtas. Salamat po sa kaligtasan at sa buhay na walang hanggan. Sa pangalan ni Jesus, Amen. Oh, sinabi mo, nanampalataya ka lang, nag-pray ka. Kaya nagkamali pa ako, hindi na importante yon. Bago ako nag-pray, sumampalataya. Naintindihan ko yung kaligtasan eh. So that's the issue. So, if you claim that you got saved because you prayed the prayer, then you are not saved. But if you got saved because you repented of your sin and put your trust in Jesus Christ, then you are saved. Even if you prayed or not, it doesn't matter. The truth is that in the Bible, there is the Republican who prayed and he was justified. He prayed. He said, Lord, be merciful to me, a sinner. And then the Lord Jesus Christ says, that person was justified. Number two, there is a person who did not pray but believe. The jailer asked, sirs, what must I do to be saved? Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. And in, I do not know where in Acts, chapter and verse, but while they are still teaching the word of God, the Holy Spirit already came down to the people. And they got saved. What is the common denominator? The Republican believe. The Philippian jailer believe. And those people believe. So it is our faith in the finished work of Jesus that saved us. What follows is inconsequential with regards to our salvation. Amen? And so many Christians are still fighting over non-essentials. Instead of growing in the faith and becoming matured in the Lord Jesus Christ. You see, if we are not growing and we are spiritually immature, we are in danger of resting the Word of God. And we are in danger of being swayed by every wind of doctrine. Ang repentance daw ay works. Maging issue rin yan when it comes to salvation. So that is the danger of not growing spiritually. And then the danger of backsliding. Hebrews 6, 4-10. Ito, na-discuss natin. Anyway, natandaan nyo pa nung di-discuss ni Brother Jeremiah Johnson. The danger of backsliding. Or maybe not just backsliding, but serious backsliding. For it is impossible for those who were once enlightened. These are saved. They were enlightened. And have tasted of the heavenly gift. And were made partakers of the Holy Ghost. You cannot be a partaker of the Holy Ghost if you are not saved. Amen? Amen. And have tasted the good word of God. And the powers of the word to come. If they shall fall away, backslide, to renew them again unto repentance, seeing they crucify to themselves the Son of God afresh, and put Him to an open shame. Hindi natin mabasahin yung iba, tuloy nyo na lang. Pero, balik tayo sa verse number 6. Tignan nyo yung phrase. If they shall fall away, they will backslide. Serious backsliding. They will revert back to Judaism. That they are still, that they are going to look for a sacrifice that they are doing every year. Or even every day, according to Hebrews chapter 10, verse 11. This is what they're doing. Because they revert back. And every priest standeth daily ministering and oftentimes offering oftentimes the same sacrifices which can never take away sins. It cannot take away sin. But they are backsliding, so they are going back to that kind of practice. So let's go back to chapter 6, verse 6, and notice this. The Bible says, if they shall fall away, to renew them again unto salvation. Diba? Nakikinig ba kayo? To renew them again unto salvation? Hindi. Hindi nawawala salvation eh. Hindi ka nare-renew sa salvation. It is impossible to renew them again unto repentance. Why? Because they reverted back to their old ways and were convinced, deceived, that that is the thing that they should do. So there is a danger of backsliding so seriously and severely that you are not going to let go of that backsliding. That is why if you will go to that a kind of a position or condition in life, as I have said, two things will happen. You will be disciplined by God and you will lose your reward. So what will happen to these people? They will live an eventful, useless life and will incur the discipline of the Lord. And the discipline of the Lord ranges from verbal to physical or even unto death. That is what they're going to incur. And they are going to lose the reward at the judgment seat of Christ. So this is the prospect of those people who are backsliding and would not want to come back again unto the fold of the Lord. They will become cast away, set aside, will not be used anymore by God. Look at 1 Corinthians 9, 24 to 27. Know ye not that they which run in a race run all, but one receiveth the prize, so run that ye may obtain. This again for the Christian. And everyone that striveth for the mastery is temperate in all things. Now they do it to obtain a corruptible crown, but we an incorruptible. I therefore so run, not as uncertainly, so fight not I, not as one that beateth the air. But I keep under my body and bring it into subjection, lest that by any means when I have preached to others, I myself should be a cast away. If you will not keep your body under subjection, you will not be disciplined, you will not do what God wants you to do, then you can be a cast away. That you are not going to be effective anymore and that you're going to be useless in the ministry and then you will lose your reward at the judgment seat of Christ in 1 Corinthians chapter 11 verses 28 to 32. The next, just note that and read it. And then, the danger of committing willful sin. Hebrews 10, 26 to 29. For if we sin willfully, after that we have received the knowledge of the truth, there remaineth no more sacrifice for sins. You see, same thing. Same thing as Hebrews chapter 6. No more sacrifice for sins. Because it is only once. It happened once. It will not happen again. So if you are going to go back, you cannot find any more sacrifice. Because it was done only once by the Lord Jesus Christ for all. Hebrews 10:10 and Hebrews 10:14. That is very clear. But a certain fearful looking for of judgment and fiery indignation which shall devour the adversaries. He that despised Moses' law died without mercy under two or three witnesses. Of how much sorer punishment suppose ye shall he be thought worthy who had trodden underfoot the Son of God and had counted the blood of the covenant wherewith he was sanctified, save. Ano ba? Wherewith he was sanctified. Sanctified na siya. Save siya ng ano? Ng blood of the covenant. Pero binaliwala niya. Binastos niya yung blood of the covenant. Wherewith he was sanctified, an unholy thing, and hath done despite unto the Spirit of grace. So this is what happened. Because he, see, the problem here is the parenthetical phrases or verse. Let's go back to 28. He that despised Moses' law died without mercy under two or three witnesses. You see, 27, the last part, 27. But a certain fearful looking of judgment and fiery indignation. When they saw that fiery, they thought of hell. That the anger of God will bring them to hell, which shall devour the adversary. So they said, see, you are now an adversary. An adversary is an enemy, and an enemy is not safe. But this is an example that the author is using in order to describe that the discipline that will happen to a person who believes in God is much sorer punishment than those who did not believe. Why? Because they have nothing to lose. They are already condemned. But we have a reward and joy and peace that is waiting for us that we are going to lose. That's why when you go to 28, he that despised Moses' law died without mercy under two or three witnesses. Connect that two and then go to 29. Of how much sorer punishment. So this is a comparison. It is not a direct object, but it is used as a comparison of how much more sorer punishment suppose he shall he be thought worthy who had trodden underfoot the Son of God and had counted the blood of the covenant wherewith he was sanctified. Still talking to a saved person, but there is going to be a judgment, a punishment, a discipline that will happen to him. What is that? Look at verse number 30. For we know him that hath said, vengeance is mine, belongeth unto me, I will recompense, saith the Lord, and again the Lord shall judge his people. Not the adversary, not the enemy. And 31. It is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. Sabi na naman ng mga cults, o kita mo, kahit nasa kamay na tayo ng Diyos, pwede pa tayong mahulog. Sabi ko, nakakaintindi ka pa. It is a fearful thing to fall into, not out of, the hands of the living God. And it is a metaphor for discipline. Para bang ganito, baka matikman mo bigat ng kamay ko. Yun ang ibig sabihin nung kaya mo to? That is what is being mentioned in Hebrews chapter 10 and verse number 31. But question, if you will sin willfully, is there still forgiveness? Yes, 1 John 1:9. Actually, all the things that we have talked about, there is still hope. If we confess our sins, He is faithful, never fail. And just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So there is no such thing as no more hope for a child of God if that child of God will just be sensitive to the still small voice that is in our heart, and that is the voice of the Holy Spirit. So paano pa sir yung sin unto death? E di wala nang remedy yun. Ano walang remedy? Yun nga yung remedy eh. Kinuha na eh. Nang sa ganon, sa langit na siya. At hindi na siya magpatuloy sa mali na kanyang ginagawa. Next, bilisan natin, natagutom na tayo. Being careless in our Christian life. Look at Hebrews 12:12-17. Wherefore lift up the hands which hang down and the feeble knees, and make straight paths for your feet, lest that which is lame be turned out of the way, but let it rather be healed. Follow peace with all men and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. Looking diligently, lest any man fail of the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness springing up trouble you, and thereby many be defiled. Lest there be any fornicator or profane person as Esau, who for one morsel of meat sold his birthright. For ye know how that afterward, when he would have inherited the blessing, he was rejected, for he found no place of repentance, that he sought it carefully with tears. Again, it looks like that we can lose our salvation. But then again, this is, again, what the author is using in order to amplify our loss if we are not going to be careful of our Christian life. If we will not be careful to obey and to mix faith with the Word of God that we are hearing in our life. That's why I will connect it to the last reason, and we will end here. That is refusing to hear the Word of God. So let's continue reading from 18 to 26. For ye are not come unto the mount that might be touched and that burned with fire, nor unto blackness and darkness and tempest, and the sound of a trumpet and the voice of words, which voice they that heard entreated that the word should not be spoken to them anymore. Ito yung nagkaroon na ng itchy ears. For they could not endure that which was commanded. And if so much as a beast touch the mountain, it shall be stoned or thrust through with a dart. And so terrible was the sight that Moses said, I exceedingly fear and quake. But ye are come unto Mount Zion and unto the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to an innumerable company of angels. Ito yung sa Old Testament. Ito na tayo. Nakuha niyo? Pinaparallel niya lang para ipakita niya yung mga nasayang dito, mga hindi nangyari, at kung ano yung masasayang dito pag hindi natin ginawa yung pinagawa sa kanila na pinagagawa din sa atin ngayon. Pero ang pagkakaiba, they have no promise and assurance of salvation, but we do have the promise and assurance of salvation. To the general assembly and church of the firstborn, which are written in heaven, and to God the judge of all, and to the spirits of just men made perfect, and to Jesus the mediator of the new covenant, and to the blood of sprinkling that speaketh better things than that of Abel. See that ye refuse not him that speaketh, for if they escape not who refuse him that spake on earth, much more shall we not escape if we turn away from him that speaketh from heaven. Whose voice then shook the earth, but now he hath promised, saying, yet once more I shake not the earth only, but also heaven. So God is serious with his dealing with us. God is serious with his plan for our lives. God is serious with all the blessings and the rewards that he wants to give us, that is telling us, If these people did not receive those things that were intended for them because of what they have done, with them not having the promise or the assurance of salvation, but with you who does have it and was the Holy Spirit and in a better situation and condition to understand everything, if you're not going to do that, then you are going to regret it for all throughout eternity. So that is, those are the judgment or the warnings that were given to us in the book of Hebrews, that we should heed the word of God, that we should obey the word of God, that we should grow into maturity so that God can use us. Because if God will use us, then many will turn to righteousness. And if many will turn to righteousness, then we are going to bring glory to God, honor to God. We will enjoy God's blessing and reward in our lives, and we are going to enjoy that reward all throughout eternity. But if not, then we are going to lose everything that God has intended to give to each and every one of us. That is why at the judgment seat of Christ, there will be tears. Tears knowing that we have bungled our chances to serve the Lord in a right way. Tears because we will see the reward that we should have received, but we lost them. Tears because we lose the chance of glorifying God in our lives. I hope and I pray that we will heed these warnings, and we are going to mix everything with faith, so that when we do those things with faith, then we can please God. And if God is pleased, then we're going to receive the things that God intends to give us, and we're going to enjoy this Christian life no matter how hard the situation or the circumstances may be. Paul experienced dire circumstances in life, but we cannot deny that he was so joyful and overwhelmed with joy because he was able to finish his course. He was able to fight a good fight, and he was able to keep the faith. I hope and I pray that those things will also happen to us, and if we are not living according to God's will, may we understand it's not too late. Let's go back to God, that the Lord may use us again. Shall we stand up?